Welcome back sa ating channel. Naging mainit nga na usapin sa mundo ng social media. Talaga naman naging bal itong siguting ng Norte na ito mula nung makumpirma ang kanyang petition. Dito nga natin mapapatunayan, mga kaibigan, na talagang gumalaw na ang matitinong mga opisyalis at mga natasan dahil banat nila ay hindi na makatarungan ang ginagawa ni Kuting ng Norte, Lisa Tanas at Tambaloslo sa loob mismo ng Malacañang, dahil nagpiepesta na lamang ang mga pulboronic user doon at hindi na nila ginagampanan ang kanilang tungkulin. Ngayon nga ay talagang nakakakilabot ang isiniwalat nga ni Ka Eric patungkol nga di umano kay Kuting ng Norte na ito at kung ano nga ba talaga ang nangyayari sa loob mismo ng Malacañang. Dito nga natin makikita, mga kaibigan, na halos tauhan ni Kuting ng Norte ang naglalaglag sa kanya dahil hindi na nila kayang makita pa ang pagpapahirap ni Kuting ng Norte sa bansang Pilipinas at lalong lalo na sa ginagawa nila na hindi makatarungan. Higit sa lahat, hindi na ganila ginagampanan ang kanilang tungkulin, nagpapabataba pa sila ng kanilang mga bulsa. Dito natin mapapatunayan na wala ng kredibilidad itong si Kuting ng Norte na ito para mamuno pa sa bansang Pilipinas. Dagdag ng maraming netizen na mas maganda nang i-take over ni Vice President Sara Duterte dahil hindi na kaya ni Kuting ng Norte at hindi niya naman gusto pala na paglingkuran ang taong bayan. Well, mga kaibigan, para nga sa karagdagang impormasyon, panoorin nga natin ang buong video. At kung bago ka lamang sa akin channel, huwag kalimutan i-click ang subscribe button at notification bell para lagi kang updated sa ating mga bagong video. At para sa sulit viewers natin dyan, maraming salamat sa walang sawang pag-suporte.
Friends to everyone, enemy to no one. Thank you so much.
Si EB po yan, guys. Si EB Hulalbot po. Si Buya Tagati po. Cebuano.
Thank you, Sir Elmer, for that very passionate presentation.
Uh-oh.
And now we move on to our video presentation by Dr. Lumel Aportadera from Iloilo.
Magaling yan si EP. Follow nyo yan, guys, sa kanyang FB page.
Musta, JC, Ka Eric.
The EDSA is a mockery
of our independence and territorial sovereignty and the violation of our constitution, particularly on the provision of our independent foreign policy. Today, we go back to the annexation of the Philippines by the United States and to history to examine the record of American duplicity in its foreign relationship. We start with the Treaty of Alliance with France by the United States. It would be the first treaty of the 13 United States of America with another state, and would be provide a de jure recognition by a global power of the existence of that America, of the fledgling American states. The Treaty of Alliance with France by the United States should be taken into the context of the events around that time. 1776 was the declaration of American independence and the War of Independence. By 1778, when the treaty was entered into by the representatives of Louis XVI and the United States, then came, towards the last decade of the 18th century, the French Revolution. The French Revolution resulted in several wars, particularly the War of the First Coalition, of monarchical powers under kings and royals against the republicanism of France at the time. France expected assistance from the United States, but the United States opted for neutrality. It was said that the Northerners were interested in trade. So during that war of First Coalition and the subsequent Napoleonic Wars, the American merchant marine fleet grew to become the second largest fleet, merchant marine fleet in the world after the British. Another reason for the neutrality stance of the Americans was that Southerners were fearful of the Republican ideals of universal brotherhood and the abolition of slavery. So during the existence of the military alliance, the United States entered into another treaty, what is known as the Jay Treaty of 17, around the last decade of the 18th century with Britain, which was a belligerent state against the Republic of France. This unilateral move of the United States would find resonance in an event in the 20th century, which I will talk later. Now we turn to the annexation of the Philippines by the United States under McKinley's benevolent assimilation, and during which the first Governor General of the United States called us their little brown brothers. From the annexation, there was a question whether the Philippines would remain part of the American, of the United States of America, either as a commonwealth like Puerto Rico, or a territory like Guam. But they opted that they could not do. At the time, we had around 7 million inhabitants. So they opted and was planning eventually to do away with our country. And it started with the Hare Post Cutting Act of 1933, which would provide independence within a period of 10 years. But this was rejected by the Philippine Senate in 1933 because it provided for a perpetual establishment of U.S. military base. This was eventually amended into what we are all know as the Tidings-McDuffie Law, a 10-year Commonwealth period followed by independence. Remember, 10-year Commonwealth period. Then there was World War II, and this interrupted the 10-year transition period provided for the Commonwealth of the Philippine Islands. With World War II, Manila became the second most devastated city after Warsaw. America did not want to provide for an extension of another 3 to 4 years that would grant independence to the Philippines by 1950 because America would shoulder the rehabilitation of the Philippine Islands. So instead, they came out with the Bale Trade Act. We have to understand that the Commonwealth of the Philippine Islands was under the United States of America. Reparations by the Empire of Japan would be provided to the mother country, the United States of America. And so they came up with this Bale Trade Act, for which reparation would come through U.S. because we were a Commonwealth. It would provide $800 million, but in exchange, we would allow parity rights and an amendment to our 1935 Constitution, which our own Senate ratified. Even an American Finance Assistant Secretary in the person of William Clayton said that the Bale Trade Act was clearly inconsistent with the foreign economic policy of the United States and clearly inconsistent with the American promise to grant the Philippines genuine independence. Then came the 1947 U.S.-Philippine Base Agreement and that of the Mutual Defense Treaty of 1951, of which there are 8 articles, and for which this military Mutual Defense Treaty of 1951 is the basis of our present EDCA. I mentioned 1951 because in 1952, the United States entered also into a Mutual Defense Treaty with the Republic of China, Taiwan, for which it has 10 articles, and the United States, in the same way it entered into the Jay Treaty of Britain in the 18th century, abrogated this Mutual Defense Treaty by the recognition of the People's Republic of China in January 1, 1979. A senator, Barry Goldwater, brought a case against the then President Carter before the U.S. Supreme Court. That Supreme Court refused to rule on that matter, calling the situation as a political question, and ever since it has been a textbook case for political questions, not only for American law students, but also for Filipinos. So we are thankful that we have forum like this because it will give us a better perspective of ourselves as a people, a better understanding of our nation, of our history as a nation. By understanding, we can then remember, and by remembering, we can act. Atin ang Pilipinas. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lumel Portadera. And up next, we have a message from Professor Celso Cainglet.
Anti-War Congress po tayo mga kaibigan, ito po sa Cebu. Kasama po si Ka-Eric, si Vic Rodriguez, Attorney Vic Rodriguez, at kasama din si Ka-Ado mga kaibigan. At marami pang mga guests.
Joshua, can you please turn on my video?
Good morning, Vito Galvan. Hello, kumusta ka na?
My video cannot be started. Josh, can you please turn on my video? Okay. Ito, maayong buntag mga maisog na kaigsugunan sa Cebu. Historically, Cebu has been a center for resistance. Hence, I believe that this maisog gathering in Cebu is a landmark in our history. About 4 years ago, my contact from the International Intelligence Network, he was a former student from the Philippine Military Academy way back in the 90s. But he left the service early and migrated somewhere. Told me, that was 4 years before all this EDCA, Hulabaloo. He said that eventually there will be war in Asia and the Philippines will be included. And the areas that will be affected will be Northern Luzon, Central Luzon, Metro Manila, Palawan, Cebu, and Southern Mindanao. I'm safe here in Iloilo. Kaya lang, pag may gera, siyempre, damay-damay na lahat. Walang kuryente, walang tubo, walang gasolina because our fuel here comes from Manila, no, Batangas. And pag may gera, siyempre, free for all yan. Looting, rape, lahat na, no? The same contact told me a few weeks ago that World War III may start this September because Jens Stoltenberg, the Secretary General of NATO, already hinted that they will strike Russia somewhere on or before September. In between, Iran happened. Just yesterday, United Kingdom happened. UK is in the verge of civil war. Just in time when UK said that they will start sending weapons to Israel, then this riot, massive riot in the United Kingdom happened. No? The world has gone dark because BBM already approved the acceptance of the Afghan refugee here in the Philippines. For sure, there are sleepers out there. Kaya alam naman natin, pag hindi tayo sumunod sa gusto ng kanok, the sleeper cells will be activated and will conduct sabotage assassination in the Philippines. No? You know, I'm not a religious person, but I like this biblical narrative. When God was about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, Abraham negotiated with God. What if there are 50 righteous people? God said, I will not destroy until they reach 10, no? So wala talaga. In this maisog rally, I see more than 10 people. So it gives me hope that we will be spared. The world has gone dark, and in this world that has gone dark, I remember a Chinese saying, it is better to light a candle than curse the darkness. Kaya sa mga kaigsuran kong maiiso, thank you for lighting a candle and let us continue to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Daghang salamat.
Thank you, Professor Kainglet. Up next, Ka Eric Celis. Ka Eric.
Mayong aga sa atong tanan, mga kasimanwa ko itong dalawang unang nagsalita, no? Si Attorney and Dr. Liumel Aportadera. I happen to work with him in the Era Presign Movement. Noong ako po ay mass leader and open urban cadre ng Communist Party of the Philippines sa buong isla ng Panay. When I was the chairperson of Bagong Alyansang Makabayan. That was from 1998 to 2001. Nag-underground ako from 2001 to 2010 sa NPA National Operations Command. So I happen to know si Dr. Aportadera. Binuo nila ang, briefly lang, binuo nila ang Code Red ng mga doktor na nagbuo ng grupo para sumama sa pagpapatalsik kay Joseph Estrada noong panahon na yon. But the Era Presign Movement was a project of the Communist Party of the Philippines. At ngayon naman, ang Maisog at ang Marcos Alisjan ay hindi project ng Communist Party of the Philippines. It should not be. It should be that way. I am familiar with this kasi ako po ay naging bahagi ng pambansang kilusang pagbubuo ng malawak na kilusang masa at mga alyansa para patalsikin ang gobyerno noon ni Joseph Estrada. Nang sumambulat ang iskandalo noon ni Chavit Singso noong October of 2000, ang unang sumalo kay Manong Chavit kaagad ay ang mga kadre ng Communist Party of the Philippines. At nilinyahan namin noon, pati ang grupo nila, late Cardinal Sin. Mga taga-Panay din niya, naging arsobispo yan sa Haro. So we have natural links to them. I don't know kung si Celso Kainglit was the director of NEDA, na kilala ko rin ang mga anak nito sa UP when I was the one in charge sa Communist Party infiltration sa dalawang campuses ng UP sa Iloilo City noong kabataan ko pa. So bago ang lahat, nagpapasalamat tayo sa grupo ng Koalisyon Kontra Giyera, nila Kamintong, nila Kaado Paglinawan, and of course ang grupo nila Attorney Vic Rodriguez na nandito, Ebi Hogalbot, at si John Abines, kanina nakita ko nandito at magsasalita rin maya-maya after nito. And of course, ang grupo nila former Undersecretary Ben Ronke. Palakpakan natin ang Marcos Alisjan at ang mamamayan ayaw sa digmaan. So we are composed of a lot of groups na nandito ngayon. At napakagandang pagkakataon nito na magkaroon tayo ng pakikipagkaisa. So I will follow Attorney Vic Rodriguez's advice to maybe we can have the discussion. Hindi ko na kukunin ng patayo, kukunin ko na ng paupo. Okay. Yun po naging background ko sa almost 21 years and 7 months ko na bahagi ako ng Communist Party of the Philippines, ng New People's Army, ng National Democratic Front. Pero may mga senior pa na mga kadre dito na nandito kanina. Alam ko si Kapit Lavinia at ang isa na sa harap ko dyan, senior pa sa akin, 1974, kadre na ng Communist Party ito, si Nick Ilman. Ginoong Nick Ilman, representative ng Hugtong Manggagawang Pilipino, siya po ay may almost 10 years na spokesperson ng Kilusang, 14 years na spokesperson ng Kilusang Mayuno. Pero wala na po kami sa Communist Party of the Philippines. Kami po ay bahagi ng tama, mapayapa at totoong makabayang paglilingkod sa ating bayan. Palakpakan po natin yon.
Palakpakan natin, guys!
Hindi na po kami babalik doon sa Communist Party of the Philippines, sa NPA at sa NDF. unang punto na gusto kong i-deliver sa araw na ito, si Mr. Marcos is not only guilty of failure of leadership and misgovernance, he is also guilty of promoting false nationalism. Ano po ang false nationalism? Parang false eyelashes din. Peke, may dalawang uri at forma ng false nationalism o pekeng pagiging makabayan. Ang isa ay yung nag-uudyo ng kontra-China pero nangungunyapit at nagpapakatuta sa Amerikano. Kaya yan ay pekeng nasyonalismo. Nag-uudyok ng tapang-tapangan at digma-digmaan laban sa China, pero tuta at utusan ng interes ng mga mapanakop at mga imperialistang Amerikano ang kanyang paninindigan. Yan po exactly ang itsura ng false nationalism ni Marcos Jr. Ang isang uri ng false nationalism ay nagsasabing sila lang ang makabayan. Sila lang ang nagmamahal ng bansa. At ang tanging solusyon sa pagbabago sa lipunan ay ang mag-armas at patayin ang kapwa Pilipino gamit ang banyagang ideolohiya ng Marxismo, Leninismo at Maoismo. Ito rin ay peking nasyonalismo ng CPP, NPA, NDF. Paano ka magmahal ng sariling bayan kung ang gamit mo ay banyagang ideolohiyang itinakwil ng kasaysayan at nabubuhay sa dugo at karahasan para patayin ang iyong kapwa Pilipino? How can that be a nationalist advocacy? Tama?
Tama.
Pero ang tawag nila sa sarili nila, Makabayan Black. Ngayon ay Makabayad Black. Yun. Kasi sila ay kasabwat na ng gobyerno ni Marcos sa pamamagitan ni Martin Romualdez.
Yeah.
So klaro ha, false nationalism. Saan tayo? Doon tayo sa tunay na makabayan. Ano ang tunay na makabayan? Ito yung binabanggit ng mga naunang speakers pa kanina sa akin. Kamintong, Kaado, si Pete Lavenia, si Ebi Hogalbot, at ang mga kasama na nagsalita, Dr. Aportadera, abogado, doktor, sila Celso Kainglit. Ang tunay na nasyonalismo o ang totoong pagkamakabayan ay ang pagsa sa puso, paglalagay sa diwa at isipan at pagsa sa buhay ng totoong pagmamahal sa ating bayan kung saan tumatayo tayo sa totoong interes ng Pilipino para sa mabuting lipunan, mabuting pamamahala at mabuting pagkakaisa ng buong mamamayan. There can never be real nationalism kung magbubulag-bulagan tayo sa mga pang-aabuso, kapalpakan at kakulangan at mga pangungurakot ng mga humahawak ng kapangyarihan sa gobyerno. Bilang mabuting mamamayan at bilang totoong nagmamahal ng bayan, we have to speak up to reform, redeem the country and put forward yung totoong agenda ng pagbabago sa lipunan at sa pamahalaan kung saan ang sentro niyan ay ang interes ng mamamayan. Hindi para pabagsakin ang gobyerno, kundi para ito ay akayin sa tamang landas ng tamang pamumuno. Real and genuine good governance. Yan po ang pundasyon ng tamang nasyonalismo. Okay. I delivered my main point. So mali po ang binabanggit ni Marcos na ang kaibigan ay Amerika at ang kalaban ay China. At once and for all, we will address also the elephant in the room. Kung ating pinupuna ang peke na nasyonalismo at ating ibinubunyag ang mapaniil, mapanakop, mapanlinlang at makaisang panig na relasyon na gustong gawin ng Amerika sa ating bansa, hindi rin po nangangahulugan na tayo ay mga apologists o propagandista ng China. It is farthest from truth. Tayo po ay hindi pro-China. Tayo po ay hindi rin pro-America. Hindi rin tayo rabidly anti-American lang na walang dahilan. Tayo po ay nagsusulong pangunahin ng tamang interes ng mamamayang Pilipino. Ano po yun? Yan mamaya palalaiman at palalamanan ni Attorney Vic Rodriguez ang former executive secretary ni Marcos Jr. na una niyang pinagkatiwalaan. Subalit, hindi sila itinadhanang magtatagal ang kanilang ugnayan sa mabuting pamamahala sapagkat may nalihis ng landas. Maaga pa. And definitely, it was not Attorney Vic Rodriguez na nalihis ng landas. Sigurado tayo doon.
Yes!
Ano pong gusto kong i-deliver na punto dito sa usapin ng panunulsol ng digmaan sa China at tapang-tapangan ni Marcos? Una, ang Amerika po, ang kanyang kasaysayan ay kasaysayan ng pananakop, pangingialam, pangungulunya, at paglulunsad ng mga digmaan, lalo na ang mga digmaan ng pangingialam. Una, we have to put forward reality and facts bilang batayan ng ating pagtingin kung ano ang trato dapat sa mga bansa na kaharap natin. Ito dapat ang ma-realize ni Pangulong Marcos Jr. at ng kanyang mga kasamahan, even ng Armed Forces of the Philippines. Number one, ituro ng Armed Forces of the Philippines, ng AFP, ni Marcos Jr. at ng mga eskolar nila na tagapagtambol that America is the model of friendship and mutual relationship that we should nurture and harness. Ito ba ang dapat nating sundan na baluktot na pagtingin kung saan sa panahon ng Filipino-American War, ang Amerika ay may pinatay na halos 1,000,000 Pilipino na hindi natin nababalikan sa kasaysayan natin kasama dyan sa pinapatay nila si General Antonio Luna. Sina Andres Bonifacio ay pinagdugtungan ng pagtataksil at pati ng pagtataksil ng Amerikano at kapwa Pilipino sa isang madugong digmaan ng Pilipinas at ng Amerika bago pang Vietnam War, ang Amerika ay pumaslang na ng almost 1,000,000 na Pilipino sa kasaysayan natin. Ituro ninyo ang pinagpapatay at minasakir ng China noon o ngayon man para sabihin natin na ang China kalaban, ang Amerika ay kaibigan. That alone is baluktot na pagtingin ni Marcos para talikuran niya ang mga madudugong karahasan at mga pananakop at pangungulo niya ng Amerika sa atin. Ang Balangiga Samar alone, malapit dito sa Sibuyan, almost 11,000 po ang pinatay ng Amerika dyan. At kinuha nila ang Balangiga Bells na tinatawag nilang war booty o tropeyo nila sa digmaan. Bata, matanda, babae, pinagpapatay nila. It was a howling wilderness.